So we were talking about dimension, and as I said, we wanted to study the dimension by using morphisms. So because we know a little bit about morphisms, we can now use them. And use morphisms. And in fact, the tool that we will mostly use are so-called finite morphisms. So I will in a moment define what finite morphism is. That is somehow define it in a somewhat algebraic way. But one property that finite morphisms have, which one will have to prove, is that they are, say, the fibers are finite. We have f from x to y, then f to the minus 1 of y will be finite for all y. And so we would expect that they preserve dimension. And so we'll show they preserve dimension. So if f from x to y is a surjective finite morphism, then the dimension of x is equal to the dimension of y. And so then we can somehow use this to study the dimension. Somehow, if you want to prove that the dimension of two things are equal, one way is to prove that there is a finite morphism, finite surjective morphism from one to the other. And it's just a question of finding always such morphisms whenever one needs them. Okay? So before, and we will somehow try to do that. And now, in order to, for this to make some sense, I have to tell you what a finite morphism is. Because this is not the defining property of a finite morphism. It's a much more algebraic concept. So so a finite morphism will be, say, of affine varieties. Will be a morphism such that, well, if you have a morphism, you can have the pullback from AY to AX. No, you can pull back. You just compose with F. And we want it in such a way that if I take F, that AX is what is called a finite, so f to the minus 1 of AY algebra. Now, so what we have is that, so I will have to explain what this means, but you have the pullback, so not f to minus f star. So we have the map in the opposite direction, f star from AY to AX. This will so the image of this pullback will be some sub ring of some kind of AX, and what we want is that AX is not so very much bigger than this, and I will have to explain how. So in order for this definition to make a definition here, I have to tell you what it means for a K algebra to be finite over another one. Okay. And so this is what I do now, definition. So let A and B be K algebras. So these are just rings with which have K as a subring. And obviously, the K should be the same in both. So this is a, A is a subalgebra of B. So it's a subring, and it's compatible with the division by K. And I say B is called finite. Over A, if you are, you know, in some sense it's like a finite dimensional vector space. So if there exist finitely many elements, say B1 to Bn in B, such that I write it like this, B is, you know, is given by, say, B1A plus BNA, by which I mean that every element of B is a linear combination of this BI with coefficients in A. Just all linear combinations of the BI with coefficients in A. So every element of B can be written as a linear combination of the BI. And one only needs finite dimension. So this is a this is somehow related to the notion of a module. So, you know, if you look at it, it looks a little bit like having a finite dimensional vector space or a vector space, you know, every element. And if it's, now we are not talking about vector spaces, because we are not over a field, but the analog of that over a ring is a module. And so that B is a finite A algebra, it will be equivalent to saying that B is a finitely generated A module, if one knows what a module is. So let me briefly recall this. We don't really need it, but you know, just put it into context. So let R be a ring. So if I have an abelian group, say B, together with the multiplication operation, together with an operation multiplication from B times, say, R times B to B, is called an R module. Well, if in a suitable sense it fulfills the axioms of a vector space over R, only that R is not a field. So if the following holds, if and only if, first, if I have, so this is for all R, R1, R2 in R, and all B, B1, B2 in B, we have the following axioms. First, R1 times R2. So I have to take the multiplication in R, and I multiply this in this sense with an element of B. This is the same as if I do it like this. Okay. So if I first multiply in the ring and then apply this to an element of B, or if I multiply twice, it's the same. So this is the, you know, associativity. And the second one is If I take an element in the ring and I multiply it with the sum of two elements in this module, then we have the distributive law. And the same, we also have it if we instead take a sum of elements in the ring. So this would be distributive law, distributivity. And the final one is that, remember that for us, a ring always contains the element 1. And so we want that the element 1 in R acts as the identity. Okay. And as I said, if instead of saying that R is a ring, we say, let R be a field and write down the same axioms, then this says this is a vector space. So it's just a precise analog of a vector space. And in principle, you know, so it's just the same thing. And now, well, you know, an R module B is called finitely generated. Well, if it's if every element can be written as a linear combination of finitely many elements, so if there exist B1 to Bn for some n in B, such that B is equal to B1R plus. So any element of B can be written as a linear combination of these of some given finite set of elements in B. And so this would correspond to a finite dimensional vector space. Okay. So some examples. So for modules, so the first, if R is a ring, so R a ring, and I in R an ideal, then it follows that I is an R module. You know, in the obvious way, via the multiplication by elements in R. Because we know the fact that I is an ideal means that whenever I multiply it by any element in R, I still land in I. So it is a module. Okay. So I could say R times I in I comes is because I is an ideal. Okay, and the other axioms are just to the fact that R itself is a ring with 1. So it's true for any elements in R, in particular if half of them are from I. So we can also, however, also do something else. We can divide by the idea. We also get a module. So if I in R is an ideal, we put A equal to be the quotient. Then I claim this is also an R module. again, in the obvious way, you know, we can multiply an element in A by an element in R by just multiplying with the class of that element in A. So by, say, if I have R times A is equal to, say, R times A with A in A, R in R, and R the class of R in A. And so we can certainly multiply in this way, and again, we are basically in a ring, so we it is evident that these axioms hold. And finally, it also works for subrings. So third, if A subset B is a subring, so with this I mean that A and B are rings in the sense of our definition, so A and B both contain 1. Okay. Then B is an A module. You know, via the multiplication in B. So I have a ring structure on B, so I can certainly multiply any element in B with any element of A, because A is after all contained in B. And these axioms hold for all elements in B, so they certainly hold for if half of them are in A and the other half are in B. Okay. So, and what's now the connection? So if, to our thing with the finiteness, well, maybe I should still leave it until I write that made statement. So if A in B are K-algebras, then by what I just wrote here, then B is an A module. And we say, and by definition, B is a finite A algebra if and only if B is a finitely generated A module. Because if you look at the definitions, they are just the same. So, so we, you know, have somehow put this into. So, so in the general language of modules, a finite B algebra, A algebra is just a, you know, an A algebra which is finitely generated as an A module. Okay, so now we want to, you know, for later use, prove a few properties of this. But maybe I should still just, I mean, either to avoid confusion or maybe to confuse you instead, relate this to another concept. Namely, you could also have the notion of a finitely generated A algebra, which is different. So, so remark, we anyway are going to use this in a moment. So there is another notion. So if again, A contained in B are rings, or K-algebras if you want, So if we have, so for B1 to Bn in B, we denote, say, A, B1 to Bn, to be, well, if you want the smallest A algebra which contains these elements, so this is the set of all, I'll take a polynomial, G evaluated on B1 to Bn, where G is any polynomial in Kx1 to Xn. So this thing, A, adjoint B1 to Bn, is the set of all elements in B. So this is obviously by definition a subset of B, which are obtained by taking any polynomial in n variables and replacing the variables by the bi. And this is called...
What is the relationship between D and set A?
What? This polynomial. Ah, yeah, no, certainly, you are right. Okay. Yeah, yeah. Otherwise, I should have called it Ka1. Yeah, you are completely right. I mean, A must play a role, and that's how it plays a role. So this is called. So this is called the A algebra generated by B1 to Bn, and B would be called a finitely generated A algebra if there exists B1 to Bn such that B is equal to AB1 to Bn. So. If there exists say B1 to Bn in B such that, well, it's generated by these elements. So this is another notion, a way how one can make a, you know, how something can be finite, but it's a much weaker statement. No? So it's clear that if so B finite over A, finite A algebra, will imply B is a finitely generated algebra, but the converse is false. Okay. So, but the converse is false. So, I mean, just as a stupid example, I mean, so for instance, if you have the polynomial in Kx is a finitely generated K algebra, but it's certainly not finite. Because being finite would mean it's a finite dimensional vector space over K, and that it certainly isn't. Okay? But I mean, that's just. Okay, so now we want to come to a few first properties of this notion. So, some kind of transitivity and, well, let's see. So this is the following proposition. takes almost longer to state than to prove because it's somewhat long. So the first statement is, now if we have three such algebras, K algebras, so it again means that B is a subalgebra of C and A is a subalgebra of B. B is finite over A, and C is finite over B, then it follows that C is finite over A. Okay, and there's a similar statement that what is it? Because it always gets it wrong. So if C is finite over A, so there's two statements, A and B, then C is finite over B. Okay. So second statement is the only thing which will turn out to be difficult. So let B over A be a finite A algebra. So then every element I just called X in B satisfies a monic equation. So I can write, for some n, x to the n plus a1 x to the minus 1 plus and so on plus I'll write it n minus 1 here plus a0 is equal to 0. So there I have such a statement. So every x in B is a 0 of such an equation with ei, or the I being element of A, and the leading coefficient is 1. So that's what makes it a monic equation. Okay. And the third statement is some kind of converse. So assume B is an element which satisfies a monic equation over A. So there's a polynomial, b to the n plus a n minus 1, b n minus 1, and so on, equal to 0, where the a I again in A. Then, if I take the A algebra generated by B, is finite over A. Okay, so let's see. So these are the statements. So the first one is, really trivial. directly from the definition. So proof. So B is finite. We assume that B is finite over A and C is finite over B. So I have B is equal to B1A plus BnA for some Bi in B. And C is equal to C1B plus CmB. So it means every element can be written as a linear combination of these BIs with coefficients in A and similar like this. Then it obviously follows that every element in B here can be written as a linear combination of the elements in I in A. So we can kind of combine this. So we have that C is equal to sum I equals 1 to n, j equals 1 to m, BI C. J. A. No, that means I can write every element of C as a linear combination of these products with coefficients in A. No, this is kind of obvious. And the second statement here, part B, is even simpler. So we have C is equal to sum. Say Ci times A. Well, A is contained in B. So if I can write it as linear combination of elements in A, I can write it with coefficients in A, I can write it as the same linear combination, which now I viewed as a one in B. So this follows. Because A is contained in B. Okay, so that was trivial. So now we come to part two, and that's a bit more interesting. We have to do some, we will do this by doing a little bit of. So in fact, it is so much more difficult that actually, as stated, it is wrong, because we will need some trick which doesn't work in this generality. So let B over A be a finite A algebra, and assume B is an integral domain. Then every element x in B satisfies a monic equation. So we have this extra assumption, which is not quite clear how one might want to use it. But we actually want to reduce it to a statement about linear algebra. And for this, if we have an integral domain, we have the quotient field. And we can somehow a statement that we have here about the modules we can actually make into statement about vector spaces, where you have learned in your first year of university how to do it. And so we want to reduce to that. So, and in fact, we will use the determinant. So if I have D equal to, say, dij, where I goes from 1 to n, and j also goes from 1 to n, an n by n matrix, with coefficients in some ring. We can define the determinant So there, you know, in linear algebra, you have had several definitions of determinant. One of them is just some crazy formula, and that's what we use. We just write down a formula. So the determinant of D is the sum over all permutations of N. So write this sigma in the symmetric group of N letters. We take the sign of the permutation times, so we take the index D1, so the element D1, where, and then we apply the permutation to the second one, times, say, D2, sigma of 2, and so on, Dn, sigma of n. So you must, I think you have had this formula somehow, no? You take all possible ways how you can pick elements out of the columns, and you sum them all up, and you do this with the sign, which is the sign of the permutation, so the number of transpositions you need to write this permutation. So minus 1 to the number of transpositions. This is one way to define the determinant. And well, so if, for instance, so if X is an element of some ring B, which contains R, we can write down, we have the determinant of, say, x times delta ij minus, that's maybe not so brilliant as notation, but anyway, that's what I did, minus dij. Now again, ij from 1 to n. So delta ij is this thing which is 1 if I is equal to j and 0 if I is different from j. So if I just take the matrix of delta ij, this will be just the identity matrix. And I take this difference. So the determinant of this, what is it? I mean, obviously you don't know precisely, because you don't know who the dij are. But you see, there's only one term in all this story which picks up an x in every factor, which is if you just take D1, D11 times D22 times D33 and so on. Or the other ones contain less often this. And if then we take this term and we develop it, it starts with x to the n. So we get that this will be equal to x to the n plus some say I equals 0 to n minus 1, say Ri times x to the I, where the Ri are elements in R. Okay? So we see that if we write down such a determinant in X, it's a monic polynomial. Well, you know, here I've called it R. You know, I can call it however I want, you know, an element. Oh, is the ring, oh, the ring was called different? So here the ring is called R. And the elements in the ring R, I could have called AI, which would have been, which I think they are called in the notes, but here I call them RI, because it feels, I mean, because I did this. So we somehow will have to see that we get our monic polynomial that we finally want here as, as such a determinant. Well, you know, if you take a solution of this, it would be an eigenvalue, yes. But we are actually, it turns out we are not interested in this question in the moment. You know, we just argue abstractly. But you are right that this is how one determines the eigenvalues of the matrix. And so that somehow it turns out that whatever is happening here has something to do with eigenvalues of some matrix. But it's not so relevant for us now. So now we want to see. But we will have to see that we somehow can produce such a thing so that the determinant is zero in order to get this. Okay, and so how we do this? So I will now, maybe I want to have the statement still there, so I write on this side. So we have that B is a finite A algebra. So we can therefore write that B is equal to sum I equals 1 to n A times BI, or BI. So now we are back to the statement where it's A. Oh, here we had general R, and now we are back to A. So maybe that was the question. BI, R in B. So if we take x times bi, x was an element in B, this is also an element in B. So we can write it as a linear combination like that. So this is equal to sum I equals 1 to n, maybe j, here I, so we don't want to call it I, so j equals 1 to n, aij times bj. No, because again, a linear combination of those. So we can use these AIJs to make a matrix for some elements in A. So now I can bring this to the other side. Then I have 0 is equal to whatever you get here. And in fact, I can write it like this. Sum over all j equals 1 to n. X times delta ij minus aij. No, that's just the same thing. You know, this is, so this is x times times bj. No, because what I've written here, if I just look at this thing, have sum x times delta ij times bj. This is just x times bj. And the other term is what we had before. So this is the same. It's just this brought to the other side. So, but what does this mean? It means if we take the matrix, so thus, if we take the vector here, b1 to bn, this is an element in the kernel of the matrix of M, with M, equal to the matrix x times delta ij minus aij, where I and j go from 1 to n. If what I'm saying here is precisely, how do I apply this matrix to this vector? I just multiply them like that, and the terms that you get is this one. And I'm saying that this is always 0. So this element lies in the kernel of this matrix. And obviously, if x was a non-zero element, this we have that this is a non-zero element in the kernel. Okay. So a non-zero element . So that is, we have a matrix which contains some non-trivial element, so a matrix which contains a non-trivial element in the kernel. Now, here the bi are elements in B. But you know, B is an integral domain, so it is a subring of its quotient field. So I can view these as the bi as elements in the quotient field. They're just elements in a field. So then we are doing normal linear algebra, and it tells us that if we have a non-trivial element in the kernel, then the determinant must be zero. Okay, so viewing the bi as elements in Q of B, which is a field, the quotient field, this implies the determinant of M is equal to zero. No, because we know that if we have, if the matrix doesn't have the full rank, so if it doesn't, I mean, if we apply it to a non-zero vector and we get zero, then the determinant is zero. And so, and this is our monic equation. So that M is a monic equation. For x. Okay, so that was a slightly tricky. And then the last one is again basically trivial because so 3 is easy. So we assume that B satisfies a monic equation over A. So if we have that B to the n plus A n minus 1, B to the n minus 1 plus and so on plus C finally E0 is equal to 0. So B satisfies such a monic equation with the AI in A. Well, then it means I can always bring bn to the other side. So every power of b which is bigger or equal to n can be expressed in terms of lower powers. Bigger or equal. So n is a linear combination of 1, b, the n minus 1, with coefficients in A. So that means that AB is equal to A plus AB plus A to the b minus 1. And we see it's finite. So the degree, yeah, okay. Okay, so this was this little proposition. So that's as much as I wanted to say for the moment about these finite, about one algebra being finite over another. Now we want to apply this to morphisms, I mean to say what a finite morphism is, and then use it, what we've learned so far for that. So I only do this for affine morphisms of affine varieties. So definition, let x and y be affine varieties so if you want you can view them as morphisms closed subvarieties of some affine spaces a morphism say phi from A to B, y A to B, x to y, is called finite. If AX is a finite phi star AY algebra. So we know that we have this the corresponding fullback phi star, which goes to from AY to AX. So phi star AY is a subring of AX, and it makes sense to ask that it would be finite. Okay? Okay, so this is what? This is this notion. So for one thing, I mean, this is just a special case of the general definition. You can define it for any morphism of varieties. So, but it's a bit more complicated to work with, and we can deal just with the case of affine varieties. But the general notion is, in general, a morphism phi from x to y, morphism of varieties, called finite. Well, if it's locally like here. So if and only if Y has an open affine cover, so it has an open cover by open subsets UI, each of which is affine. So so y equal to u1 union un, such that the inverse image of the ui are also affine, that phi to the minus 1 of ui is affine for all I, and as a morphism from wi to ui, it's a finite morphism. It's finite. Okay, so this is the general notion. It works very well and so on. But you see, because of this thing with the cover and so on, it's a bit more difficult to use, so we somehow will avoid that. And then some more practical things. So I never, let's see. So if Y subset X is a closed subvariety, of an affine variety, so if two affine varieties, one contained in another, then I can look at the inclusion so if we have this, the inclusion is a finite morphism. So the embedding of a closed subvariety into a bigger variety is a finite morphism, and that's clear because in this case, if I take the pullback, it's surjective. No, if you just think of the definition, we have that say AX is equal to say K, if you are in AN, KX1 to XN divided by the idea of X, and AY is equal to the same thing divided by the ideal of Y. And Y is contained in X. So we have that IY contains IX. And the I star is just the canonical map. The canonical projection. No, just every element is sent to the corresponding class there. So in particular, it's certainly surjective. And then the third statement is just some other trivial observation which we'll use about 100 times. So let so if we have so how it works with compositions, so let phi from x to y and psi from y to z be morphisms. And then we have first, if both are finite, so of a fine variety, so if phi and psi are both finite, then the composition is. And the second one is, if the composition is finite, then the first map is. Hope I got it right. Yeah. So, and this is a direct consequence of this proposition we had before. If you remember, we had the proposition that if we have A contained in B, contained in C, are K algebras, and if A, B over A and C over B are finite, then A over C is finite. This just directly translates into the statement. It's the same thing. No, you just put in what it is. You know, you put A is equal to A of Z, B is equal A of Y, and C is equal A of X, and then it's just that statement. And the other thing is, if we also had the statement, if A over C is finite, then if C over A is finite, then C over B is finite, and this is precisely this statement. So it's just a translation of the composition. And there's one particular case when we want to use it, which is a bit more trivial, but which just saves a little bit of headache. So in particular, if phi from x to y is finite, and we have that the image is contained in some closed subvariety with W subset X closed subvariety. Then if I take phi, as a map from X to W is also finite. Okay. And this is just, we just use this for the inclusion of W into Y. We use this statement here. We know that, and it's just the same statement. What? What? What?
W.
Ah.
No. In the second line.
Ah, yeah. Okay. So. Yeah. W is in Y. Otherwise, it wouldn't make sense. Thank you. Okay. So that's this. Now we want to start looking a little bit at the topological properties of finite maps. So there's the one important property of finite maps is that they are closed. So the image of a closed subset is closed. So remember that if a homomorphism from a projective variety is always closed, that was a it has to do with the completeness of the projective variety. For affine varieties, it's not the case. If you have a morphism from an affine variety, it doesn't have to be closed, but if it's finite, it will be closed. So morphisms, finite morphisms are closed. So now I will have to work on that. First, we start with some stupid remark. So if X is an affine variety, and E is an ideal in the coordinate ring of X, is proper ideal, then if I take the zero set of this ideal, which I just mean the set of all points P in X, such that, say, F of P is equal to zero for all F in I, this thing will not be the empty set. Now, this looks very much like the Nullstellensatz, and it's obviously a straightforward consequence of the Nullstellensatz. So, proof. This is from the Nullstellensatz. Namely, we have pi, the canonical projection from the polynomials to ax, which is just kx1 to xn divided by the ideal of x, have this surjective map. Then obviously, if I take the inverse image of I, this is now an ideal in this polynomial ring. Is an ideal and it will be a proper ideal. No, it's obviously a proper ideal because otherwise this would have to be the whole thing. So then it follows by the Nullstellensatz bei den usual Nullstellensatz. We have that the zero set of pi to the minus 1 of I is non-empty, but you know this is the zero set in An, but by definition this is just the same as the zero set of I. No? Okay, so this was this remark. And now we come to the statement, which is what I just wrote there. So I write it again. So theorem, finite morphisms are closed. So this is a bit more difficult, so we will have to work a little bit. So first we make some reduction. So let f from x to y be a finite morphism. I mean, we assume they are, by our definition, we assume that x and y are fine. So we take a closed subset, or we can as well take a closed subvariety of x, and we have to show that the image is closed in y. If we show this for every irreducible closed subset, it's enough because the image will be the union of the images, the finite union of closed subsets. So for let W, is it W? Yeah, X be closed subvariety. So we have to show that F of W is closed in Y. Okay, so we put let Z be the closure of W in Y, of F of W in Y. So then we have to show that Z is equal to F of W. But then we could also say, so now we see, we can now just replace x by z and y by f of w. Then we are in the situation that, you know, if we restrict z, so let me see. Then we are in the situation that we have a finite morphism, because as a restriction of a finite morphism, this morphism is still finite. And the image is dense. No? And we have to show the map is surjective. So replacing x by w and y by z, we have to show so let f from now again I call an x and y from x to y be a finite morphism of affine varieties. With dense image. So if you want a dominant morphism. then it follows F is surjective. Okay, so this is the same statement. We have just restricted, So and this is, we want to prove this. We have a finite morphism with dense image, then it is surjective. So, so as we know that f of x is dense in y, we have that the pullback map f of a star from a y to a x is injective. So I've used this before, I think. I never proved it, but now you actually have got it as an exercise. Okay. So you can convince yourself. it's quite simple. So for simplicity, I identify the inverse image F star of AY with its image, so AY with its image F star of AY in AX. So I can view AY as a subring of AX. No? Just to save some notation, basically. So we have that y is in the fine variety. We can assume it lies in some an as a closed subvariety. So we assume that y lies in an. And we take p, a point in y. We have to show, so any point, an arbitrary point in y. So we have to show that the fiber over this point is non-empty, that it lies in the image. No, because if we show this for every point, the map is surjective. So to show we have to show that f to the minus 1 of p is non-empty. And now we want to make this to an algebraic statement. So if we take m, so we call x1 to xn the coordinates on an. So we take and write down a maximal ideal m, which is just ideal generated by x1 minus a1 xn minus an. So this is the ideal of all the functions which vanish at p, no, the ideal in k1 to xn doing this. But I mean, here, the xi actually are supposed to be the coordinate functions. So not the coordinates, but the classes in ax, okay? Ay. Because we are, y is an n. So this is some ideal in ay. And now I want to consider, you know, I have viewed AY as a subring of AX. So I now want to look at the ideal in AX, which is generated by M. Okay? So we look at AX times M. So let B the set of all elements we take, say, A times M, where A is an element in AX and M is an element in M. So this is the idea generated in AX by M. And now why do I consider this? Because I claim that this ideal, the zero set of this ideal, is the fiber. So if I look at f to the minus 1 of p, this is equal to what? Well, obviously, this is the set of all q and x, such that f of q is equal to p. But what does it mean to be equal to p? It means that the ith coordinate of f of q is ai. Okay, so that means this is the set of all q and x such that if I take x I minus ai and compose it, so of f of p, this is equal to 0 for all I. Or in other words, we have this is the set of all q and x, such that if I take f upper star of xi minus ai, or I just say, so xi minus ai composed with f is equal to 0. Of p, or it's the same, for all I. But, here we have, maybe it was nonsense to identify this with the pullback, just means the pullback of xi minus ai is equal to 0 at q. So this means with this identification, I have xi minus ai is equal to 0. So, so I claim this is, I will have to think how to say it better. So I claim this is equal to 0 set of ax times m. So these are all the points where, where xi minus ai vanish. And so this is the same as the zero set of the ideal generated by these. But remember that now we are in x. So we have to take the ideal in ax generated by these. And this is just this ax times m. Okay. And now, so we find that the fiber is the zero set of this thing. But now we use this remark I made before, that the zero set will be non-empty if and only if this thing is not the whole of the ring. So it's enough to show. That AX times M is not equal to AX. It's a proper ideal. Then the zero set will be non-empty. Okay, and so this is then the last step, and we make this into a lemma of its own right. So thus it's enough to prove the following lemma. So let B be a finite A algebra. Assume B is an integral domain. So this is a lemma. Assume B is an integral domain. Let I in A be a proper ideal. Then if I take Bi in B is a proper ideal. So this will work because in our case, obviously, we have that A is equal to Ay, B is equal to Ax. We have assumed that X was reducible, was a variety, so AX is an integral domain. And then we have the statement and the thing that we had before, and this precisely says that if this is true, we have made the assumption that, so this M is obviously a proper ideal in Ay, it is actually a maximal ideal. So, and we want to show that the ideal generated by M in Ax is a proper ideal, because then, by what I wrote here, we find that the fiber is non-empty. Okay? And so we have to prove only this lemma. Here we again have this, this crazy condition with the integral domain, so we will again have to do something with the determinant. No? Because that's where it comes from. So let's go do the proof. So now we make an indirect proof. So assume that Bi is equal to B. And then we will make a contradiction. So we know that B is a finite A algebra, so we can write B equal to, say, AB1 plus ABN, where the Bi are elements in B. We know that Bi is equal to B, so we have B. Well, let me take the next page. Yeah, I don't need this anymore. So B is equal to Bi or IB, whatever. So this means I can multiply this thing, an element of B by an element in I here. So if I do this, every element in A is made into an element of I. So I can write this as IB1 plus IBN in the combinations of elements in I. Okay? So in particular, the Bi are elements in B, so they can be written in this form. So in particular, we have that Bi can be written as sum j equals 1 to n aij bj, where the aij are now elements of I. And now we do the same, what? Now we do the same trick as before. We write m equal to the matrix. Oh, now we don't need the x, delta ij minus aij, I and j go from 1 to n. So we have this matrix. And we know that, you know, we bring this on the other side. We see that this matrix applied to the vector b1 to bn is 0. So we have that m b1 to bn is equal to 0. No? That's what the formula above says. So that means, so again, view M as a matrix with coefficients, so in the quotient field of B, which is now a field, then if an element contains something in its kernel, then the determinant of the matrix was 0. We find det of M is equal to 0. Now we have again to remember the definition of the determinant. You know, it was this sum over all the permutations. And so there's precisely one element, which is this diagonal one, where we just have this delta 1,1 minus a 1,1 and so on, the whole sum like this. And all the other ones are divisible by some aij, which lies in I. So it follows, and now if we take just this diagonal term, then it's again, if you multiply it out, it will be 1 plus something in I. So we find altogether that det m, so 0, is equal to the det of m, is equal to 1 plus sum over sum L CL, where L is where CL is an element in I. So we get, okay, so 0 is equal to 1 plus something in I. So thus, you know, how can this be? We can bring the 1 to the other side. So we find that 1 lies in I. So that means I is not a proper idea. And this is either a contradiction, if you want, or one could call it the contraposition. Namely, we find that if bi is not a proper ideal, then I was not a proper ideal in A. And so we have proven it. And then with this, we proved that finally that finite morphisms are closed. So that's a nice place to stop.